Thank God for His mercy today. Glory and power and honor. I was thinking, I was looking back at that stained glass window as we were singing that song, and that's John baptizing Jesus in the Jordan River, and what it must have been like for the dove to descend. You know what that dove was? It was the Holy Spirit of God. You know what descends on this place when believers gather together and worship the Lord? That same dove that descended there on the Jordan River is the very same dove that descends on God's people. Amen? Boy, it's good to be in the presence of the Lord and to worship Him in spirit and in truth. Same Holy Spirit. Same God. You know, we read through this book and we read wonderful things. Same God that did those things. Same God that still moves today. The angels told him, this same Jesus which is taken up from you is going to come again. This same Holy Spirit which descended in the Word of God is the same one that still moves on believers. And you say, preacher, what are we missing then? Activation. Car won't drive unless you turn it on.
Come on, drive.
Right?
Come on. Come on.
We got to activate what's already inside of us. What God's already done through us. I've studied this, just getting ready for this series of sermons. I'm a thinker. I lay in the bed at night and I think. I just think. I'm a thinker. Tiffany always says she knows I'm thinking because I pull at, I call it my beard. Matt would call it my peach fuzz. It just depends on what perspective you're speaking from. Man, I was laying in the bed the other night and I was thinking about this phrase I'm going to preach on here in just a moment. And when something's just a story, it's not real to you. But when you begin to realize that all that Christ did, He did for me. He didn't do it for the masses. He did it for me as an individual. Brother Billy, He loved me as Blake so much. And everything that He did for me. And you know, I really believe this, and I'm convinced of this with all of my heart. If I would have been the only one that standed in need of redemption, I believe He loves me so much that He would have gone for just one. I really believe that's how much God loves me. That if nobody else needed salvation but me, I believe He still would have gone just for me. Man, what a God. What a God we serve today. I want you to turn with me this morning to Luke chapter 23. When you get to Luke chapter 23, I want you to find verse 26 this morning. I want to begin preaching up to Easter a series of sermons called Love's Seven Greatest Phrases. And this morning I want to preach on a word of forgiveness. A word of forgiveness. Brother Billy, I remember you saying one time, you said if we just took John chapter 3 verse 16, there's enough there that we could preach it from now until the Lord comes back. And when you talk about the death of Christ, it is a subject that we could preach on for all of eternity and we could never explore all of the depths. But we get this opportunity to explore just a little bit of it as the gospel writers record for us what exactly Jesus said as He was on the cross. We don't know if this was all that He said. Perhaps He said more. But we find that these seven phrases were so important in the minds of the gospel writers that they felt need to record it for us so that we might could study it. Christ died via a method of execution called crucifixion. It was a common method of carrying out the death sentence in the Roman Empire in the ancient world. Most definitely the cruelest and most painful method of death that the Romans knew. Reserved only for those who were the worst criminals. Roman citizens viewed crucifixion as such a painful experience that they would not even inflict it on their own citizens. If you're a Roman citizen, you could not be crucified. Crucifixion was usually a long and slow process that was carried out sometime over days. Jesus Christ hung on the cross only 6 hours. You say, preacher, why was his shorter than the rest? Because he said, I take my life up and I lay my life down. Jesus died when he wanted to die, and he rose again when he wanted to rise again. Do you have that power? I sure don't. And it reminds us that even when he looked vulnerable, even when he looked as if he had lost control, he was still in control. I'm reminded of what he told Pilate. He said, the only power you have is the power that God allows you to have. And anything else is still in my hands. A.W. Pink's a great writer. He said 4 things about Christ's death. He said, number one, Christ's death. Now, I want you to write these down because this is good to know. Number one, Christ's death was natural. What does that mean, preacher? It means that he died a real death. Christ's death was natural in that he came to this world and he died a real human death. The life left his body. It was natural. Number two, it was unnatural. A.W. Pink says it was unnatural because though death has a claim on you and I, death had no claim on him. The Bible says in Hebrews, it's appointed unto men once to die and then the judgment, but Christ had no appointed death date. He took one so that when you and I die, we don't have to face judgment, we don't have to face the end, but we actually can step into eternity with Jesus Christ our Lord and all those believers who have placed their faith in him. His death was unnatural. A.W. Pink, and I've never heard this word before, I got to be honest with you, said not only was his death natural and unnatural, but it was preternatural. Now there's a word I've never heard before. Anybody heard that word before? No, me neither. He said, preacher, what does that mean? It means that it was predetermined and marked out. Revelation calls him the Lamb that was slain before the foundations of the world were formed. That means God solved your problem before you ever had it. Come on. Wasn't that a good God? People tell me sometimes, my mother-in-law loves to tell me this, as if she didn't spoil all of her children. She likes to say, you're spoiled. Your parents spoil you. And I think, well, what'd you do with yours? But anyway. And then I want to say, what'd your mama do to you too? But anyway, that's the conversation for another day. But it was preternatural. It was predetermined. It was marked out. You know, I'll be honest with you. I got great parents. I've been pretty spoiled. You know, God spoiled us. He said, listen, I'm going to solve this problem for you before you ever even have to walk through it. And you know, God does that. You say, yeah, but preacher, boy, we got a lot of problems we got to fight. Actually, no. Actually, you don't. Jesus just said, listen, if you got burdens, bring them to me and I'll take them. Right. You got problems, bring them to me and I'll carry it. You got heavy yokes, if you'll bring them to me, I'll give you mine. And it's a lot lighter and it's a lot easier to carry. You say, preacher, why is my life so discontented, so miserable? That's your fault. That's not God's fault. Because you hadn't done what he told you to do. He prescribed you a medication and you won't take it like he says you ought to. And so you carry all these burdens in this life. It was predetermined. It was marked out. Then it was also supernatural. They did not kill him, but he laid his life down. And in his dying state, he made 7 statements. And I would say to you this morning that love has never been on greater display than in these 7 sayings that Jesus Christ made on the cross. The Bible says this in Luke chapter 23, verse 26. Now as they led him away, they laid hold of a certain man, Simon, a Cyrenian, who was coming from the country, and on him they laid the cross that he might bear it after Jesus. And a great multitude of the people followed him, and women who also mourned and lamented him. But Jesus, turning to them, said, daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For indeed the days are coming in which they will say, blessed are the barren wombs that never bore and breasts which never nursed. Then they will begin to say to the mountains, fall on us, and to the hills, cover us. For if they do these things in the green wood, what will be done in the dry? There were also 2 other criminals led with him to be put to death. When they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right hand and the other on the left hand. And Jesus said to them this, Father, I want you to notice as we go through this series very clearly the way that Jesus identifies God as he's talking to him. In this first phrase, he calls him Father. He says, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. And they divided his garments and cast lots. Father, help us to preach this morning with Holy Spirit anointing. Lord, there are many subjects that we handle and many subjects that we no doubt mishandle. But Lord, this is one subject that we want to get right. So help us to preach this morning, Lord. Help us to preach with Holy Spirit anointing and clarity. And you do through this time what only you can do. Set our words on fire today. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. I want you to notice with me this morning very quickly. I'm not going to say very quickly because these sermons probably won't be very quickly. Amen. But I'm going to do my best. That scares some of y'all. But anyway, I want you to notice as we look at this phrase, three things that Christ does. As he says, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Number one, I think this is a good observation. Number one, Christ prayed. Number one, Christ prayed. The Bible says when he found himself in a sticky situation, in a situation that even he had never faced before, death, the Bible says that Jesus Christ, our Savior, prayed to God the Father. Now, there's two reasons why he did that. There's two reasons why Jesus Christ prayed on the cross. Number one, write this word down. It was a pattern. It was a pattern. What do you do when you find yourself in a crisis? What do you do when you find yourself as he was surrounded by the enemy? Those feet had walked the countryside, had carried the gospel all throughout the known world in those days, and now those feet were nailed to a cross. Those hands had healed. They had caused blind to see. They had called lame to leap, dead to live, those with withered hands to be made whole. He had done all kind of healing with these hands, but now these hands are nailed to a cross and incapable of doing anything. And so when you find yourself in a crisis and when you find yourself surrounded by the enemy, I'm not asking you what Christ did. I'm asking you what you as a believer do. Can I tell you what our Savior did? He prayed. He didn't start running through how he could fix it. He didn't start thinking about what kind of solutions he could provide. He didn't start thinking about how he could get himself off the cross. The first thing he did is he looked toward heaven and he prayed to God the Father. Yes. Now, I could pull out a whole lot of theological points that you may or may not understand as I go through this series of sermons, but one of the things I want to strive to do is to give you some application from the life of Jesus Christ. And one thing you can learn today is this: stop trying to solve your own problems in life and give them over to the Lord. He said, Father, I'm going to tell you something. When my mama says, Rodney, he don't come always, but when I say, Dad, he comes. They say, why is that? I mean, there's a lot of reasons why that is, probably because he knows she wants him to do something. But you'll understand this if you're a parent. There's a certain sound to the voice of a child calling out for you, isn't there? Isn't there? And there's even more of a distinct sound when a child calls out to you in distress. In distress. You come running. No doubt his voice was in distress and he looked up in heaven and he said, Father. He prayed. You know what I thought as I was studying this? I thought, with nails driven through his hand, thorns beating into his skull, lashes all over him, no doubt burning. I thought this, who in their right mind would think to pray? I would think to myself, how could I position my body better where it won't hurt as bad? Or I would be thinking, how long is it going to take for this process to complete? But as the Son of God hangs on the cross, he thinks in all of his agony and all of his pain to stop and pray. You know why he did that? Because that's all he'd ever known. I wrote some examples down. Luke chapter 3 verse 21 says that when Jesus first started his ministry, you know what he did? He prayed. When the crowds were busy and hustling and bustling around him, Luke chapter 5 verse 16 says that Jesus would steal away and he would pray. Matthew chapter 14, the Bible says that before Jesus stepped out and walked on the water, he prayed. The Bible says that before Jesus was transfigured on the Mount of Transfiguration, he prayed. The Bible says that when Jesus was in the Garden of experiencing the separation from God the Father, bearing the weight of all the sins of humanity on his shoulders, he prayed. We don't pray in the good times. Prayer is a habit, just like anything else. You start praying, build it as a habit. You'll find that when you get yourself in a crisis, the first thing you'll think to do is to stop and pray. You know what happens to me when I pray in crisis? I get peace. I get peace. When I find myself in a crisis, my world gets dark. I don't know if all of you work like that. I don't know if your mind works like that. But when situations around me go bad, oftentimes my world goes dark. This thing almost cut off. Just short it out. My world gets dark and gets bleak around me. You go into a bout of depression. But when situations around you begin to turn bad, the first thing you begin to stop and do, and you just begin to pray. It is amazing to me how God's peace can invade your heart. And you can begin to understand what he truly means when he says, listen, we're overcomers. We're victorious. Yeah, this life throws us tough situations, throws us situations that we cannot handle, but we're victorious in Jesus Christ. Rejoice in the Lord always, he said, and again I say rejoice. Not only did he pray because it was a pattern, but he prayed because it had power. This man, this God man, had witnessed and been a part of many great answered prayers. And he knew that there was great power in prayer. And notice as he hangs on the cross, not only does he pray, but notice this with me. Boy, this blows my mind. Not only does he pray, but he prays for others. How much praying for others have you done lately? Say amen right there. Just make sure you're still with me. Let me ask that question one more time, because I get convicted of this sometimes too. How much praying have you done for others? Oh man, it's easy for me to get wrapped up in my little world, praying for my problems. God bless my ministry, bless my home, bless my marriage, bless my job, bless my finances. Bless me with what I need. At a leadership meeting last Sunday, I said, in the coming weeks, I'll tell you what's expected of you, and I want you to tell me what you expect of me. And I said, the first thing you ought to ask me is to pray for you. Yes. I said, because if you don't ask, technically I'm not bound, and I want to be bound. I want to be accountable to pray for you. So many times we get wrapped up, and Jesus prays for others. And here's the biggest thing that blows my mind. He don't just pray for anybody. He actually prays for the people that are standing around nailing him to the cross. He's not praying for the disciples saying, oh Lord, I'm about to die, strengthen them, help them to carry on the gospel. He says, no, these that are standing around me, Father, forgive them.
Come on.
They don't even have any clue what they're doing. Tells us two things, doesn't it? Number one, it tells us that as a believer, you know what you have to do to people who do you wrong? You got to love them. Oh, I thought I'd get a better response out of that. Let me say that one more again. It tells you that as a believer in Jesus Christ, you know what you got to do to those who wrong you? You got to love them in Jesus Christ. Oh, but preacher, I like to get even. Yeah, I do too. And can I tell you a little secret? I'm doggone good at it.
Come on.
Matter of fact, I don't get even. My brother always said we don't get even. We get back tenfold. Huh? And so, we have to love those who do us wrong. Jesus prayed for his enemy. Can you imagine this? Can you imagine when those soldiers, they got done, they took him off the cross, they carried him away, and they got back to the barracks, they were just sitting around talking. And obviously, all of them didn't go because they had legions and legions of armies there. All the soldiers wasn't at the crucifixion of Jesus. And some of them who were there must have went back to the barracks, and some guy must ask one of them who was there, he must have said, tell me about it. What happened? What was it like? And he said, you won't believe this. He said, you know what he did? And he said, what? He said he prayed for us while he was dying. It's not so hard to believe then why one of them stood around him and said, truly this was the Son of God. It's not so hard to believe then why it was that his identity was revealed to him, because he did things that are not natural to the human nature. Human nature says, get angry, get even, get vengeful, take justice. But Jesus Christ says, love when you deserve to hate. Forgive when you deserve to hold grudges. We have to love those who do us wrong. Then notice this, though, secondly. Boy, this is good for some of us in here today. Not only do we have to love those who do us wrong, but then it also teaches us that nobody is beyond the reach of God. Amen. Boy, if anybody should have been beyond the reach of God, it should have been those sorry jokers that put the Son of God to death, right? But he said, no, forgive them. And you know what? Jesus doesn't pray prayers that can't be answered. So if they couldn't have got forgiveness, he wouldn't have prayed for their forgiveness. But the fact that he looked up toward heaven and said, Father, forgive them, means that if they would have turned to the Lord, then they could have actually received forgiveness. You say, preacher, you really mean that? Now listen to this. This is amazing to me. Christ prayed that they would be forgiven in their ignorance. He said, forgive them, Lord, for they don't understand what they're doing. Now here's an unbelievable thing. This will blow your mind. This will absolutely blow your mind. Acts chapter 3, verse 17. Peter's preaching. He's preaching. Hadn't been that long since the Lord died. He's preaching to a big group of people. Big old group of people. Some of them Romans, some of them Jews. We're right at the day of Pentecost. They're in Jerusalem. The Romans are occupying Jerusalem at this time. So he's preaching to a big old crowd of people. Some of them Jews, some of them Romans. Whole bunch of people he's preaching to. This is what the Bible says in Acts chapter 3, verse 17. I've never seen this. This will blow your mind. Peter says this, yet now, brethren, I know that you did it in ignorance. You say, preacher, what's ignorance? When you don't know what you're doing. Now, ignorance is not always excusable. You're going down the road, you're going 75 and a 55, and you tell the officer of the law, you say, I didn't know I was going that fast. And he's going to say, I don't care. You were going that fast. Ignorance of the law, we say, is no excuse. But ignorance is not knowing what you're doing. Now, what did Jesus say? He said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. Now, here's what Peter says in Acts chapter 3, verse 17. Yet now, brethren, I know that you did it in ignorance, as did also your rulers. But those things which God foretold by the mouth of all his prophets that the Christ would suffer, he has fulfilled. Now Peter says, repent and be converted that your sins may be blotted out. And you know what happened when he preached that message? 3,000 of them did just that. They repented and they believed. And you know, I'm just foolish enough to believe that maybe one of those 3,000 was a Roman soldier. Maybe even one of them who stood under the feet of Jesus as they crucified him. And I'm just foolish enough to believe that one of those 3,000 people was one of those nasty Jews who was standing at the steps of Pilate's hall saying, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. And I just believe that you would, if you were able to see the 3,000 who came to the Lord, you wouldn't believe the awful, vile, and wretched people that made up that number. But it reminds us that not only is forgiveness for those who are just kind of bad, but forgiveness and repentance and grace and mercy is for those who are really bad. And all of those who have been born into this world, Christ died so that they could be saved. And you might even say this, when he said, Father, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing, he wasn't just talking about the ones standing around him, he was talking about all of those who crucify him afresh every single day. God died for those very people. Nobody is beyond the reach of God's grace. Doesn't matter where you've been. Doesn't matter what you've done. Doesn't matter how bad you've gotten away. Doesn't matter how many times you've rejected God. You might have cursed God. You might have called him every name in the book. He still loves you. You say, preacher, why is that? Listen, dear friend, nothing we could do could surprise God. You think Jesus was hanging on the cross and he was surprised that humans had the capability to crucify the Son of God? Absolutely not. If anybody knows the wretchedness of man, it's Jesus Christ. And he died with that very problem in mind. He prayed. Secondly, he proved. He proved. I need to hurry. What did he prove? Number one, he proved the words of the prophets. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 12, the Bible says this. Listen, all the way back in the Old Testament, the prophet Isaiah prophesied this. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 12, the Bible says that the Savior would make intercession for the transgressors. Intercession for the transgressors. You say, preacher, who were the transgressors that he was making intercession for? Those around him. He said, Father, forgive them. Do you understand something? Christ still makes intercession for us today. You go to the throne room of heaven, Brother Billy, and you say, God, I've done this, and I need to be forgiven. You know, it actually goes to the Holy Spirit, who intercedes for us, and he actually takes it to God the Son, who is, you might call, our defense attorney. And then he carries it into the courtroom of God, and he said, this is the offense that's been committed, and we're seeking forgiveness. And God the Father says, on what basis? And he says, on the basis of the shed blood at Calvary.
Amen. Come on.
See, he still makes intercession for us today. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 12, all the way back in the Old Testament, that Christ would make intercession for the transgressors. But you know what it also says in that chapter? It says he was numbered with the transgressors. We just read here just a moment ago, the Bible says in verse 33, when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him and the criminals. And the criminals. You say, why did he write it that way? Well, there was three men there, and only two of them were justly accused. One on the right hand and the other on the left. He was numbered with the transgressors. Christ made intercession. If you go through Isaiah chapter 53, read all the prophecies that were made. It said Jesus would be despised and rejected of men. He'd be a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. He'd be wounded, bruised, chastised. He'd be led like a lamb led to the slaughter. He'd be dumb before his shears, suffer at the hands of man, be bruised by the Lord, pour out his soul unto death, buried in a rich man's tomb. And then it was added that he would be numbered with the transgressors and he would make intercession for them. And he fulfilled that. And he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He thought of those around him. He pleaded for those who were crucifying him. And he made intercession for their forgiveness. He proved the words of the prophet, but then secondly, this morning, he proved the wretchedness of the people. He said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Now, here's the thing. They knew what they were doing. They were mentally cognizant of what they were doing. The implication here is not that those that crucified Christ were somehow under the influence of some supernatural power and they were made to do what they did. No. They knew what they were doing. Those who went before Pilate and said, we want him crucified, give us Barabbas, they knew what they were doing. They chose Barabbas over Jesus. The soldiers who carried him up the hill, they knew what they were doing. Everyone in this situation knew what they were doing. What they did not know was the enormity of what they were doing. He said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. He said, they don't realize the bigness, if that's a word, of it all. They don't realize the bigness of it all. Oh, one might say, preacher, they got to be excused. I mean, it'd be a pretty hard thing to believe in those days as a mighty big thing for one to be God in flesh, for one to be the Son of God. Oh, they had so much evidence if they would have just looked around. The words of the prophets had been fulfilled. The works had been done before him. John chapter 7 says that never had a man spoken like him, and yet they were still ignorant of who he was. You say, preacher, it's a scary thing, isn't it? You know it really is? Because we all have the propensity and the potential to be ignorant of who he is. No doubt there's somebody in this room today who's been in the presence of God and they don't even realize they've been in the presence of God. They've experienced the worship. They've seen people cry. They've seen people raise hands. They've seen people say amen. Seen people give. They've been in the presence of God. They've been in the presence of worship, but no doubt they're sitting here and they don't realize it. You say, How could you stand in the presence of God and not know it's Him. That speaks to the blindness of the human heart. Henry Blackaby said that believers ought to find out where God's moving, and they ought to just go there and get in on what God's doing. And so what I pray is, Lord, help me to see. Help me to see where you are. Help me to see where you're moving. Help me to see where you're moving. Help me to see where your presence is. See, if the disciples would have prayed, Lord, help me to see where you're moving and working, then they would have been at the feet of the cross and not at home in hiding. You see, if Peter would have prayed to God that God would reveal to him where he was moving and where he was working, then rather than denying him, Peter would have loudly and boldly proclaimed and professed, Jesus Christ is my Lord. You say, boy, if Peter could slip and fall, any of us could, couldn't we? Yeah, we sure could. And my goodness, if Christ prayed when he found himself in a crisis, we better be on our knees before the Lord. Not only did Christ pray, Christ prayed, but then thirdly this morning, I'll be done very quickly, Christ provided. Number one, he provided an escape from judgment. What is the ground on which a holy God will forgive sins? A.W. Pink said there's a great difference between divine forgiveness and human forgiveness. Human forgiveness is often a matter of leniency. It's a matter of laxity. It's a matter of letting things go. Sometimes in class, my kids do things that deserve to be punished, but because they wear you down in such a way, you just say, you know what, that one's not worth fighting today. It's a matter of leniency. Sometimes a person will go before a judge, and they'll stand before a judge, and they'll be accused of some crime. Mark, if you pull somebody over and they're speeding, what you ought to do is write them a ticket. But did you write everybody a ticket that you pulled over? Obviously not. Sometimes situations are taken into effect. Sometimes people's circumstances are taken into effect. And sometimes, in human forgiveness, we show leniency. Now here's the problem. We serve a God that is both just and merciful. And His desire when it comes to us is to be merciful. But in His justice, He cannot ignore our sin and our wrongdoing. So what does He do? He looks at us and His heart is filled with love, and He says, for them, I want to show mercy. But I can't just set aside my holiness. So one of two things has to happen. Either He has to pour out His punishment on us, or somebody has to stand in our place and take the punishment for us. Do you understand something, students? Christ did no wrong. And some of you were saved this weekend. Do you understand how great that is? That God did something for you that no one else could do. You had a problem that you could not fix on your own. You had a problem that your mama couldn't fix for you, daddy couldn't fix for you, I couldn't fix for you. Nobody could fix it for you. Only God could fix it. And you know what Jesus did? Every wrong you've ever done, every lie you've ever told, every time you've ever cursed, every time you've disrespected an adult, a teacher, a parent, every time you did something you shouldn't have done, every time you offended the holiness of God, He poured the punishment of that sin on His Son, Jesus, so that you wouldn't have to take it. He poured it on Him, crushed Him with our sins. I received a bill the other day. We bought our projectors. We hadn't got them up yet. And they sent a bill to the house. And it told how much it was. And then down at the bottom, there had been stamped on it in red ink. It said, paid in full. Boy, don't you like when bills come in and they have already stamped on them, paid in full? That's a good feeling, ain't it? Man, it's a good feeling. I don't get many of them. And you know, literally what happens when we're saved is Christ takes the bill of our sin and He takes the stamp. And maybe instead of dipping it in the ink of this world, He dips it in the red blood that He shed at Calvary, and He presses it down on that bill, and it says, paid in full. Paid in full. You say, preacher, we deserve that? Absolutely not. Only through the mercy of Jesus Christ do we escape the judgment that was set aside for us. Then finally this morning, I'll be done. Not only did He give us an escape from judgment, but He gave us an example of love. I call these love's greatest phrases. You say, preacher, explain how this is love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, Paul said in 1 Corinthians 13:4, love suffers long. Love suffers long. And then he said in verse 7, love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Love, he said at the end, never fails. I'll tell you what I want to do this morning. I want Connie to come. I want David to come and sing the love of God for hymn of invitation. And as we just reflect on what God's done for us this morning, it's good to know what God's already done for us, but it's also good to take some application away from these passages of Scripture. Number one, what Christ teaches us about the importance of prayer in the life of the believer. What God teaches us about how we're to treat those who have done us wrong in the life of a believer. Somebody wrongs you, love them. You're facing a crisis today, quit trying to solve problems by yourself and pray to the Lord. Ask for His peace. But today, may we just take this time just to worship Him through invitation as we reflect on the words of this song. And may we just be just completely consumed and overwhelmed by the wonderful, marvelous love of God that is so overwhelming. There's a little line in the bottom of that hymn, and it's pretty fascinating if you read it. What page is that? You know, 220. And it says at the bottom of the page, it says the last stanza of this song. Well, let me read it to you. It says, could we with ink the ocean fill, were all the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. And if you look down at the bottom of that page, it says, the last stanza of the last verse of this song was penciled on the wall of a narrow room of an asylum by a man who was said to have been demented and insane. Boy, if an insane man can get it like that, surely we can get it today, sitting here in the presence of the Lord, to say, oh God, thank You for Your love. Thank You for Your forgiveness. Thank You for the intercession that You make as You stand before God the Father and say, Father, forgive them. On what basis? On their goodness? He says, oh heavens, no. But on the basis of the shed blood of Jesus Christ given at Calvary. I'm going to pray for us and we'll stand. Father, we thank You for Your love. Thank You for Your forgiveness. Oh God, how it pours into our hearts. We begin to understand how blessed we are to be forgiven by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And Father, I thank You this morning that though we're undeserving, unworthy, and wretched sinners, You have cried out to the Father, not for justice, not for judgment, not for wrath, not for vengeance, but Lord, You've cried out to the Father on our behalf for forgiveness, for mercy, for love, for compassion. Oh, how blessed we are when we think of that phrase, forgive them, Father, for they do not know what they do. God, my heart's overwhelmed with conviction because so many times I have to ask for forgiveness, not for the things that I don't know that I'm doing, but God, I just deliberately sin against you. Lord, forgive me for the things that I know that I'm doing. Help me to be right with you. Lord, use this time of invitation for your honor and your glory. We'll be sure to praise you for it. It's in Christ's name. Amen.